Sometime in December 2005, a developer duo, Mark Headley and Dave Smith, who were working for Lionhead Studios at the time, were discussing a game that a character controls similar to the previous game, Ragdoll Kung Fu, that would be playable on the console. Ragdoll Kung Fu, itself being a game that was made for PC, developed during the time Headley and Smith were at Lionhead Studios. The game in of itself featured sporadic movements in a unique experience, to say the least. Well, with that foundation in mind, they wanted to do something different, along with others being Alex Evans and art director Kareem Etorni. Mark and Dave managed to arrange a meeting with Phil Harrison, the then head of development for SCE Worldwide Studios. In that meeting, an idea was unveiled, a game called Craft World, a physics-based 2D side-scrolling game with a placeholder character called Mr. Yellowhead. Mr. Yellowhead's arms were controllable with the right analog stick of the PlayStation 2 controller that they had connected to their PC, whilst his legs were controlled with the left stick. The objective of the game was to guide Mr. Yellowhead past a number of obstacles by grabbing onto objects and pushing or rolling them around. While strange on paper, it seemed intriguing enough to the representative. By their own admission, the pitch was vague, and they had deliberately toned down the creative aspect of the game, which they felt may have appeared as weird for a console game for fear of negative reception of their pitch by Sony. However, regardless of that, the meeting, which had been scheduled to last 45 minutes, eventually lasted 3 hours. At the end of which, Sony agreed to fund the project for 6 months. Following this, Sony gave them a deal to develop for the PlayStation 3 in exchange for exclusivity and ownership of the intellectual property. And with that, on January 4th, 2006, a small but determined group of friends created what is known today as Media Molecule. Media Molecule became incorporated as a company in February of 2006, and ever since then, they took off. Me and a plethora of other people love the raw creative energy put into the game so much, and the fact that we were able to do the same in Repercussion only spiked the love in general. When it comes to any other game, there are a few downsides to it. Little Big Planet had no fucking downsides. This shit was the Jesus of games. Story mode, created not only to entertain the player, but to reward the player with the same items in the story mode itself, because the game alone was made with the same tools given to the player, therefore inspiring the player to make their own levels on the same quality spectrum and levels. Holy fuck! Create mode, you can use the items and make your own with the same aforementioned logic the creators made for you and them to make levels and items on and share with the online community. Shit was easy as shit to make too. In 6 months, game reached 1 million levels created by players, let alone the DLC, created by third-party companies that made epic fucking levels varying on the DLCs you bought. Most of them were just a bunch of cool-ass costumes. Metal Gear Solid went all out and had these poor people coding a fucking gun in a children's game to be used in all aspects. Of course, it wasn't an actual gun, you fucking idiot. It was just used as one by everyone else, which I'll get to in a second. Online mode. A balls-to-the-walls hellscape that was fun to watch crash and burn in the most beautiful ways. Remember when I said this game has no flaws? I lied. Fuck you, haha. You wanna know something else? Christmas isn't real. Ooh, are you gonna cry? Hi, little baby? Shut the fuck up. The community, like for many other pieces of media at the time, was a slobbering cesspool. and still is today for some, but a rare amount, are as sadistic as the niggas who ran the massive train on the online aspects of Little Big Planet. Clickbait was a thriving thing, having the suggested section being flooded with fake giveaways.
Who would do this? Well, actually, a lot of kids would do this.
Game-destroying glitches that were later patched thank the fucking ceiling. Porn! Lots of low-quality porn! Why was there so much porn? And forget you not, this was the time of the 2000s, where everyone was blaring Linkin Park, Blink-182, and the Snow Monkeys, that's not what they were called. So, of course, a lot of emo kids were on there as well.
This is Joseph. This is Joseph.
Shooting everyone and blinking distance, whatever that means, with the guns mentioned earlier. But hey, ignoring all that, there's a lot of fun to be had. Media Molecule themselves started handpicking some beyond good levels made by the community. And even then, when you found a decent level by yourself, you want to follow that creator and share the same experience with your friends. The online features are unmatched by any game in my humble opinion, and I owe it to this game for expanding my creativity in my friend group. Some of the niggas I know to this day. And if that wasn't amazing enough, Little Big Planet 2 was released a few years later, and that shit had me more excited than a zombie in Black Ops 2. January 18th, 2011, Little Big Planet drops and absolutely blows away expectations. It was like Little Big Planet 1, but cracked out on all aspects. Going off the same aspects of the gun, the story mode alone had unique items. Grappling hooks.
Use the left stick to then do your super heroic moves and stuff.
Head cannons.
Like anything to your heart's content.
And the 2003 cult classic, the Hulk cans that every suburban Kyle had to have.
And you can also pick up sack people too and throw them.
And to top it all off, more in-game items to collect. Why did I write the script like this? Fuck. The create mode and online mode were more interactive as well. Sporting the PlayStation Move controller was a new efficient way to play and create in the game, even getting its own DLC. And for some reason, the online mode put a complete 180. Quality levels are everywhere. I can only name a handful of bad levels, and that's only because number one, my brain repressed most of them, and number two, most of the bad levels were made by me. Okay, there we go. And oh, cool. That was the end of the level, by the way. That little platform. That was supposed to be the end of the level. And I guess I just fucking broke it. Only the Lord knows how. Jesus fucking Christ. Now, with this whole pattern occurring, Media Molecule completely overstepping themselves with each sequel, you in the present day would think, hey, it's been a whole 10 years now since Little Big Planet 2. They must have had a really, 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 really good sequel by now, right? Well, no. And no. After their wild success with the series and gaining awards en masse, they aimed their ambitions solely on new projects like Tearaway and Dreams. One of them will be the sequel to this video. See what I did there? Because the sequel of the sequel is going to be a sequel video to the sequel of the game that I'm talking about. Because the sequel is supposed to be a sequel of... I'm going to die alone. Media Molecule wanted to step away from the Little Big Planet series, but they said they will always be involved with the franchise, and I'm glad that came to fruition with the announcement of the new IP, Sackboy's Big Adventure. According to development logs, Little Big Planet 3 began development in 2011, shortly after the release of Little Big Planet 2. Most of the development was handled by Sumo Digital. However, series creator Media Molecule provided assistance, particularly during the project's early stages. Now I know what you're thinking. Why this company? Why? Why Sumo Digital, of all people? They could have gave it to Lionsgate, which they worked with beforehand. They could have gave it to Tarza Studios, the people who worked on most of the DLCs for the first ones. But why Sumo Digital? Well, I'll tell you. Sumo Digital is actually Titan in game development. Yeah, that's right. They are the fierce, knowledgeable minds behind such cult classics that invoke creativity, much like the fathers of Little Big Planet itself. Let me tell you, they are unmatched in the gaming spectrum. Oh, who can forget such cult classics like Team Sonic Racing?
What's going on? Holy shit, that shell card!
Hey, what the fuck is this hack?
And Forza Horizon 4. And ooh, who can forget Crackdown 3?
But what happens when evil comes out of the shadows? We do what we always do. We go to work.
Side note, I'm just finding this out now amid research, and the preceding context makes sense now. But who cares? They got the darker Dwayne Rock Johnson in one of their games.
Power!
Me being ignorant to the game having a different developer at the time was due to the new features that the game had, such as, instead of operating on three layers, there's a whopping 16. Good luck with that one, kid. You can now make your own items. You wanted to make an actual gun? Well, now you can. Several, actually. There's a lot of militia people on there. I'm genuinely scared. And introducing to the solo roster of Sax, three new characters who are creative as ever. You can definitely tell with these designs and these concepts for characters, they spent years trying to develop these characters and their functions. So get ready for them. Such as Toggle, a man who can go from big to small. Oddsock, a dog creature who can jump off walls and swoop. I'm not even gonna put an image. You should be able to assume what it is. With these three game-changing factors, it's set up an appearance of a promising game to push the boundaries once again, as any installment is expected to do at this point. Key word here is appearance. Then the game came out. Little side story, beforehand, I didn't own a PS4 until 2017, so I was forced to make do with the PS3 version of Little Big Planet 3, and I'll tell you, if you're not already aware, any next-gen game that is sold slash ported to the previous generation sucks major dick, such major dick, and balls, and cock, and penis, and this can be due to a varying amount of reasons. A dumbed-down experience, low quality, enough bugs to make blathers from Animal Crossing jump off a highway intersection, never to be seen again. I'll get back to this point in a second. My personal experience with both the PS3 and PS4, yes, I bought this twice because Sony hates my pockets, experience was meh. And I think I speak for the community when I say that. First of all, when it came to the story mode, there was this huge feeling of disconnect. Instead of playing this family-like creation with lovable characters that have key traits that bring them to life and have a reason to be in the story, period, we play a bombastic but boring story mode in LBP3 where the characters are forgettable, the levels are barely innovative, the game's key functions, and you get the sense that the game was rushed. And who can blame you? It probably was. In the early stages of development, Media Molecule stressed to Sumo Digital that the game's story must set a good example to what players can accomplish themselves in creative mode. And while it did that exactly, it was difficult to even come close. You may be confused by what I just said, so let me explain. When it came to the story mode in LBP 1 and 2, the functions of the game were obvious and that was intentional. Media Molecule wanted this to be groundwork for everyone else to work off of. Even the bosses that they made had the functioning pieces out up front so you can see what was actually going on with them. This gave the future creator, aka the current player, a sense of humility. A message that says, hey Sweatfox, you can do this too, you can pass this test. And, oh, I accidentally dropped the answer sheet right by your little toes, by your little sweet sweaty toes, you sweaty fuck. Don't you dare tell anyone else, tee-hee-hee, don't tell us to the million of other players that are going to play through this. With the last two games, it was like an infant fighting infant. And if the last two games were like an infant fighting an infant, the third one was like Hulk Hogan beating the shit out of that infant, then blending up the damn thing for protein. Basically, the story mode seemed amazing in concept, but in terms of reiterating by the player, it was terrible. The create mode was the worst part for me personally. Here's something I left out. A very tedious function of create mode was completing the tutorials. While this may seem optional, it wasn't. For some reason, every single tool or gadget or logic you may want to use in the game must be given to you after you do a tutorial level. So that means finding that specific tool in the large index of the tutorials, clicking the level, waiting for it to load. Playing for 2 minutes to get the stupid shit, exit the level and waiting for your pod to load, and making the level. Only then, you get to use the magical gadget. And even then, you probably forgot how it works. Look at you, you dumb fucking baby, you baby fuck, you sweat fuck. Ha ha! You dumb idiot! This makes this an inherited issue, meaning that it wasn't solely Sumo Digital's fault. It was MM's as well. But that is completely out the window when it comes to how Sumo Digital decided the worst of the problem. The complicated functions that were in the story mode had an effect, and there were more tools than ever. So, you had to do the tutorial levels for each one of them. I'd rather pull out my fucking fingernails by hand than do that shit again. Online mode is actually pretty decent compared to everything else. Players made the most complicated games and blew the socks off the community. While it felt like fucking rocket science trying to figure out how shit worked in the game, when the brave souls of the LBP3 community threw an idea at the wall, it pretty much stuck, if anything. Even without the knowledge of the new complicated logic, everyone made what they could. And it was cool, because at moments, it felt just like LBP1, a complicated hellscape, but that was just for nostalgia's sake. Now, these three issues would be just fine in a game. Not great, but fine. Not everything has to live up to expectations. I mean, look at me, I'm wasting my hours fucking up on an audio recording, on a video, on a kid's game. But hey, like I said, everything aforementioned about the game will be just fine. If the game fucking worked, you remember when I talked about how bad the port was? Well, this one was one of the rare cases where the port was just as bad as the original, and if anything, worse. People's saved content was deleted by glitches in the system. That means years of creating and saving content, whether that be a complicated item or old level, can just be eviscerated for no discernible reason. Just because Sumo Digital doesn't know how to fucking code. Creating levels was a bug in of itself. While the content and expectations were high, the limit to what could be used in a fucking single level was not. You know how ass backwards it is to be the next installment of a DIY game that has more creative limits than its predecessors? Meanwhile, in trying to play with niggas, trying to play with niggas, whether it be a friend or a random person you meet thanks to the dive-in feature, is as frustrating as putting your head between two colliding cement trucks. Disconnection, after disconnection, after game freeze, after disconnection, after disconnection, after disconnection, after game. You get the point. Media Molecule's child was technically slaughtered for everyone to see. It was a terrible sight to see. Let this be an example as to why you should never let someone take over your passion projects or something you worked on. I can promise you this much. Mark Headley and Dave Smith were probably not proud of what they did with this poor little sack boy. So, like I said beforehand, never let someone take over your passion projects or something you worked on. Or should I say dreams? Get it? Because the video...
Deep voice and they coming with the big chat. They're so clean like a money machine. Now you...